the ultimate Final Fantasy podcast with your hosts, Joseph the Dildo Dandy DeGaulier and Caleb Spice in my chest. They talk about Final Fantasy and shit. So listen up, you nerds.
From Provo, Utah, this is the ultimate Final Fantasy podcast with your hosts, Joseph DeGaulier.
That's me.
And Caleb Schweiss. This is Ultima Final Fantasy.
Welcome to another episode of Ultima Final Fantasy, the ultimate Final Fantasy podcast. Did you not know we were recording? I look up at Caleb Craig, who is on our episode today. I look up and Caleb's just looking at his phone. He hears me talking. He looks up at me all confused. And then he slowly puts his phone in his pocket.
I did not know that the recording had started.
Okay. Oh. All right. Well, that's very good. I am Joe the Dildo Dandy DeGaulier, apparently.
Yeah, you are.
Craig. I am Caleb Schweiss.
And today, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to be going through... I was looking for fan theories like we had done before, like the Necron theory from Final Fantasy IX. Rinoa is Ultimacia. Squall is dead. FF7 and FF10 connections.
All
sort
bullshit,
of things.
Right? Except for the FF7 and 10 one.
FF7 and 10 one is canon. It's still bullshit, but it's canon. So... I found a list, and it's from Ranker.com, and it's called The 11 Craziest Fan Theories That Connects the FF Games Together. And it is a shitty fucking article, but we are going to go through all 11 of these theories, and we're going to go through them and decide whether or not they're true or not in our discussion segment. But before we get to that, Caleb Craig, where are you in Final
In 14? I'm level 17, and I haven't played in 2 months.
2 months? I thought you were going to say 2 years. I'm like, oh, that sounds right.
No, I played it like a little bit recently.
Oh, that's
trying
nice.
To catch up with you guys, and then I decided, nah.
Yeah, what made you decide, nah? What was holding you back?
Cam was going to play with me, and then he didn't, so.
Oh.
Play with me.
So I decided, nah.
I was going to say, other than the obvious, what was holding you back, but.
Wait. What?
The obvious mental impairment that
oh,
is.
Oh, wow. That's so much worse.
Yeah, well, it's so obvious you had to
so
point
true.
It out.
Yeah, it is true. Last time you had a really hard time with 14 because you chose a tank class, didn't you?
Yeah, that was...
You chose the one class in the game where you need to know the game.
Yeah.
Inside and out. You need... Like, if there's a tank and he doesn't know his way around, like, a minorly complex dungeon, it is bad.
Yeah, it makes it a giant pain.
Well, it
ass.
Wasn't even, like, a complex dungeon. It was, like, the first one that has you do with, like, a group of people. And
yes,
like, and then it was just
and
a bunch of like level
verbal abuse.
Well, it was just a bunch of like level 50 people going to a lower level thing for some reason, and they just decided to hate on me and kick me out. I was like, "What the fuck?"
They actually vote to boot you in that?
That's
never happened.
They
to me,
voted to boot me, and I was like, "What the fuck? This is my
you
first
must have deserved
time
it.
Playing this." No, dude, I was doing what I was supposed to. Like, I just wasn't like a super high level. I had no idea what I was doing.
I don't think anybody should start as a tank in 14.
No, you shouldn't.
I think that's probably like a class to go to after you've already played the game, just because you'll have done the dungeons like a million times because of your dailies, and you'll know your way around, and then you'll know what makes a good tank before you be a tank. You know what I mean? It's just, it's not your fault necessarily. I mean, it's certainly the game and the bad community that like kicked you out. Did you tell them it was your first time playing 14?
Yeah.
Like, was that in your speech?
Yeah.
It was probably the Independence Day. Was probably the Independence Day 2 speech where they're all like, yeah, this is going to be awesome. And then it sucks. And they're like, oh, well, fuck this guy.
Well, the 12 people who saw Independence Day 2 will know what you're talking about.
The 12 people that saw the worst movie of this year.
Yeah,
yes.
Dude, it made so little money in North America. And it's like, it's Independence Day. It's
our holiday, man.
Movie.
Doesn't matter.
And the first movie celebrated America to the point where the British were like, we can't do anything till the Americans get here.
Yeah.
Which is the best, worst scene in any movie, by the way. That first one where they're like, oh, the Americans, they're what are they doing? They're doing a counter counter reaction or whatever, and the other guy goes, "Well, it's about bloody time." I love that moment because it's like, yeah, America, fuck yeah.
Yeah,
it's great. It's great. But yeah, that movie made so little money in North America. It made like way more in China.
Yeah.
Than it did.
So that was Caleb's speech, though. And that's why they booted you.
Yeah. Booted you because of your speech? Dude, I got a story from 14, so I'm in the middle of Stormblood like you are.
Stormblood?
Just kidding. I'm in the middle of a bog of trailers for news for Stormblood, so I'm thinking of Stormblood right now. Heavensward. I'm in the middle of Heavensward like you are, and I was in a, and you think you waited up for me for a dungeon. I appreciate that.
Have continued to wait, yes. By the way.
Oh, we haven't done it.
No, we haven't.
Never mind. now, there, I was doing a daily, and this tank was just, we were doing extremely well in this group, okay?
Okay.
We were going through this dungeon like it was nothing, like it was butter. And the tank was just like picking off guys one at a time, and it was making the game really easy, and I was doing a really good job. Everybody was doing great. We were killing the guys really quickly. And then the douche black mage like pops up, and he's like, "Hey, so I think we can do more than just you can pull in more guys, Mr. Tank." He was telling the tank, "You know, we can handle more. We're doing really great." And the tank goes, "You know, I'm going to tank the way I want to tank." And then the black mage goes, "Well, look, I main the class. I think it was warrior. I main warrior. So I know you can handle more than this." And then the tank's like, "No, I'm going to tank the way I want to tank." And then they like get in a fucking fight. We're doing great. We're almost near the end of the fucking dungeon. And the guy is like, "Well, we could kill more people. So come on, I do this job." And frankly, he was being a douche about it. Like, he's like, "I know how to tank really well. And I'm sorry, we can do more than this."
Yeah.
Like, it was half like, "Come on, we're doing a good job. Let's do more." And then half like, "I can do your job and you're not doing it right." And then the tank gets all pissy, and we get in this big area with like a lot of dudes attacking us, and the tank just stands there and he stops doing his job. We all get fucking melted. And then he goes, "You don't have to tell me how to do my job. Fuck you guys. You know, I don't need any of this. This is just a game anyway." And then he quits the thing. And I was like, I'm mad at the black mage, frankly, who was like, "Yeah, I can do the job," because we were doing just fine, and he had to be like, "Meh." That's what he had to do. He just had to like take his shit coming from his esophagus, and he had to like put it, he had to type his poison into the chat to piss off the tank who was doing just fine. And then we got screwed over. And luckily a tank came in and saved our asses, but it was like near the end of the dungeon. Like, why even?
Yeah.
Why?
That's pretty crappy. Like, at least when I get on you about your healing, like, I know I can do it better. But it's a little different. Like, I know that. But with this guy, you don't know that.
Fuck you.
No one knows that.
He knows that.
That's actually not quite true, though, because you've got the Heavensward main story content items on your white mage, and I definitely don't.
Okay.
Right. So I am good at switching from combat to healing, but my items are so garbage that it wouldn't even matter, I don't think.
Yeah, and then we went in a dungeon, one of the main story ones. It was a huge level with, like, the mechs.
Yeah, the end of 2.5.
And my god, no one was waiting up for anyone.
Yeah, and it got to the point where, like, it was like, okay, Joe died, and I waited for Joe, and then I got left behind. And then, like, one of the tanks died, and then, like, the second tank died, and these guys were so gung-ho, they still went in there. And it was like, I was like, they're really going for it. Cause,
they
like,
went so far ahead, I was fucking lost, dude. I couldn't find him again.
Yeah, yeah. It was bad. And I had to go back and, like,
it was
help
fucking
him.
Terrible. I'm like, there's so much XP we're missing out on because these guys are like, "Let's do this thing as fast as possible."
Yeah, you still get XP.
I know you still get XP. You don't get XP for every single guy that you could have killed.
That's true, but
there
no
was a
one,
lot they were skipping.
No one kills everybody anymore, though. It's with the main scenario, they just leave it. I agree, but it's funny because
I'm trying,
like,
to level up. I'm not doing dailies for any other fucking reason.
Yeah, that's true. But you do get a bulk of it from actually completing it. So I think it's like a XP per minute thing where like you get more if you finish it faster.
That's what they're trying to do, it faster to do more quests.
Yeah. But it was funny because I was watching the health bars up top, like, okay, there's the one tank, he's taking damage, okay, that he died, and then like they kept going and like they kept going and like both of the tank's health bars were like max, and then they weren't in the fight, and like the DPS guys were just like chunk. And then we get up there and they're all just like waiting outside the area that they
where
all
where are you
in.
Guys I yeah. don't know. Fuck you! I didn't have my auto skip cutscene thing on, so you know it takes like, I don't know, 5 seconds to get out of a cutscene when it starts, and then it's you got to press the back button and then exit, and then it kind of fades away. By that time, they're fucking out of there.
Yeah, they're gone.
And I'm like, what the fuck? What if this was the first time I was doing this thing?
Well, I don't think it would put you in there though. I think the daily is a separate queue, so.
Sometimes I question that because sometimes people view the whole cutscenes.
Oh yeah, you know, and sometimes stuff like what happened with
me. I'm not
me.
Saying you're wrong. I if that's the case, I don't know why the fuck people are viewing the cutscenes.
Yeah, I ran into a shitty moment this week in 14 as well, where I was doing one of the guild tests because there are like 5 or 6 dailies you can do each day, and there's a silver trophy for doing 100 guild tests. I don't know how far away I am. I should be like right there, but it hasn't popped yet, so whatever. And I go in, and it's the one where there are like 6 or 7 flying dudes, and you have to get them all really low health and then kill them all really quickly, right? And they... everyone just kept killing them. Like, we had some guy who was just like auto-attacking, and I'm like, hey... we can't kill him. We have to kill him all at the same time, right? And then, like, no one says anything. And then he goes to, like, the next guy, goes in and kills, and he wipes him out. And I'm like, hey, look, we can't do this. And, like, I was the white mage at this time, so, like, I'm also trying to deal damage. And, like, one of the other guys is like, just keep us alive. And I'm like, why keep you alive if you're not even doing the fucking dungeon? Like, he's like, just don't worry about damage. Just make sure I don't die. And I'm like, yeah, I know. That is the white mage's job.
That's the only thing
we seriously, we can't complete this, whether you're alive or not. And I ran out of mana. Like, it was so bad. They kept killing the fucking guys over and over again that I was out of mana. I can't heal you anymore. It's gone. Stop fucking up. And then, like, they leave, and then some other guy joins in, and he's all cheery, like, hey, guys, what's up? We're gonna do this. And I'm like, dude, we can't do this, man. And he's like, oh, that's crazy. We can knock it out. Goes in there. There's the auto-attacker guy that, like, I swear to God, he's a bot, because every time he spawns, he just runs back in and, like, starts attacking again. And the tank guy is like, oh, just make sure I stay alive. We'll be able to knock it out. And it just fucking levels us. Like, all 7 of them just descend on this poor fuck. And then, like... and it's awful, because if you don't want your penalty, you have to wait till 15 minutes has passed. So I was in there. I was just standing there, and I was like, I'm not going to play this anymore, to that other guy. And he's like, yeah, I don't blame you. And I'm like, we both left at the 15-minute mark. But it was horrible. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, like, how many times do I have to tell you how to fucking do this dungeon? Like, you know that little screen that pops up in the beginning that says, oh, hey, here's your objective. Maybe you should read it if you don't fucking know. Or read the chat where I'm like, hey, asshole, stop killing everything. I want to get out of here. It's like a 5-minute fucking thing, but no, you're going to make it an hour because you're fucking, you've got some shit going on upstairs that's not normal, and you just can't read, and you're fucking something, man. And it's seriously like a 3-minute excursion. That's what it should be. But I had to wait 15 minutes just to leave and to get into another one. These people, man. And, like, it was never this bad before. Dailies, last time we played 14, it was just a breeze. Like, I just did them. I didn't have
bad experiences. There's definitely some record of that in this podcast.
Really? Yeah. It was smooth for me. Smooth
sailing.
There's
been some fucking assholes, and then I remember there was this one time where the tank was a bot, and that was just the worst experience.
Yeah, there was one where the... oh, man, it was like... I think the white mage left... or something, and I was like a scholar class. I had to heal and do damage. It was insane. It was so nuts. Like, I was, or no, I think I was black mage, and I was using my heal ability, and we totally beat the dungeon. It was awesome, but it was like damn near impossible. It was that it was that manor one too, the Halatali Manor or whatever.
I hate
so like
that one, dude.
So like I have to run over and like turn off the little fire things, the lanterns, while healing people while doing damage, like. There were a few times, but it wasn't like just total stupidity like it has been lately. And I'm just like, what?
I think the dungeons are getting better in Heavensward, though.
Yeah.
There's only been a few, and then there's been some alternate ones that there's a lot that I've been opening up because I've been seeing the guy, the little plus sign things. Still haven't tried them though. We got to go through some extra dungeons at some point. And our question from us to you last time, not the episode that Jake and all of them just did, but the, yeah, the one before, was like, what three things do you want us to do in Heavensward? We got to look at that and
yeah, we do,
kind of go through it and see what we want to do in that, that old Heavensward. I'm excited to get to all that stuff.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. So we're like 2/3 of the way, maybe a little more, 3/4 of the way through Heavensward's story, and then we also have the Dragon Song Wars or whatever after that. Mm-hmm. So the big thing that's been stopping us has been that new Boreas's shitty level, because I've been waiting at that dungeon for like a week now. Although we did go to a Metallica concert, oh, so yeah, every day that we would have played, we didn't play. So
that was a great concert, though.
Yeah, it was.
Fucking, dude, Metallica was better this time than they were in Salt Lake 8 years ago.
Well, that's because this is a better studio than...
A better studio?
A better venue.
Better venue? I don't know how to...
The Energy Solutions Arena is not made for music, dude.
But they were in the arena, so they were in the middle, and that was something really cool. And like Lars's drum set would like spin around, and so that he would shift every song, he'd be in a new spot. And then it was just different. I know they do a different kind of sound system for the arena shows. They weren't like Bon Jovi where he was in the corner or anything like that. They were right in the center.
Yeah.
And I was kind of like, oh, I was kind of missing that on this one. I thought that's what they were going to do because they were in a sports stadium, so it's a big round thing, but they just didn't.
Well, it was the middle basically, yeah, though. Like,
but God, I told you, man, like the production value in those Metallica shows with like the lights and the screens and the lasers and the flames crap on top of the performance. It's great.
It was a lot of fun. So it was worth it.
I've never seen a show that big before. It's like incredible.
It was worth the missing of 14. So
it is. I'm sorry. Final Fantasy. Metallica is my first love.
Yeah. Yeah, that's fair.
All right, we do have some news this week.
News, you don't have to talk, Craig.
Don't tell
yet.
News. All right,
so, some news. Surprisingly light, considering we haven't actually done an episode for.
There's a lot of news that Shinru gave us. By the way, if you want to see all of Shinru's news, sometimes he posts a thing once a week that has big headlines in it, and then you can go into the forums and it says news for this week or whatever.
Yeah,
and you can go look all that stuff up. Now we clear through it and we decide what's important, or if there's repeat news, then we kind of like, oh, we don't need to go into depth on that on the show. But thank you, Shinru, and thank you to Lion Heart of Light, I think is the name of the other person who sent us one thing of news before Shinru got to it, and
yeah,
was really proud of it.
He was pretty excited, yeah.
Loki of Light, Lion... I don't remember. Sorry. I know who you are, though. So, thank you. Our first piece of news, and this was an interesting piece of news. A lot of people tweeted this at me. Final Fantasy VII Remake development, which was going to be centered kind of on external teams or other companies that Square Enix was giving out the workload to with the Final Fantasy VII Remake. They have now decided to shift it, whatever this means, to an internal focus. So they're going to be making most of the game in-house instead of with other companies.
Oh, so they're going to do their own game. That's...
What?
Yeah, that's crazy talk.
Hey, now, remember our history of Square Enix. The history of Enix is mostly other people making games and then them publishing it, so... Square Enix is now a publishing company and an in-house gaming company.
Yeah.
So when you put those two companies together, it can be quite loose, you know. And Enix is the big one now. It's basically Enix.
Yeah.
So if you think about that, that's not unusual.
No, it's not, but it is their IP, so it feels like perhaps they should make it themselves, because they have been this entire time, for the most part.
The big games, yes.
Barring a few one-offs. Oh, and Seven's remake isn't going to be a big game, is that what you're saying?
I think it definitely is going to be a big game. This is another clue of that.
Well, yeah, but they weren't in the beginning, and if they didn't think it was going to be a big game before, then they're fucking retarded. They only did it because they want the money for it. They're not doing it for
no one
any
knows
other
the
reason.
Exact reasons.
It's just... for them recreating Final Fantasy VII, no one knows the exact reason. No, dude, it's money.
No one knows the exact reason to contract it out to another company.
Yeah, that's true.
Probably because they had a lot of workload going into 15.
What's the dollars and cents thing going on?
It might be cheaper, but it's, I don't know, it's like a big...
Would it be cheaper, though?
I would assume so. Why else would you do it? I mean, unless you just did not have the resources.
Yeah, that's what I would think.
But this is a huge deal. Like, they're not making 16, as far as we know, so...
I hope they are.
And Kingdom Hearts 3 has been being made for the last, like, 700 years, so that's clearly not on the front fucking burner. I don't know. It's like...
What does the front fucking burner look
like? It's the one that, like, you pull... It's like a hidden burner that you pull out from the side. It opens up like a switchblade. It just, like... Tsh, and it's got... It's really fucking hot. That's the front fucking burner. It's like a little bonus burner.
Mm, I thought it was
the burner that leaves a lot of bugs.
Yeah, yeah. There you go.
All right. So this is something you know a little bit more about. This is the Final Fantasy V 4 Job Fiesta. Which a lot of people have been telling us to tell people about.
Yeah, so, you know. If you guys want, they do have a... It's an event for Child's Play Charity, apparently, and its schedule is now to June 18th for pre-registration. Looks like they have June 19th through August 31st. They play, and then you're supposed to, like, hashtag it.
Like a live stream sort of situation.
Yeah, it is. Okay. It is. It looks like any legit version of FF5 is accepted. It's like a big old thing. You guys can check out the article we have. I don't know if I have time for this.
No, people are asking us to volunteer, and we said no. But if you want to volunteer, you can, of course, do that. Final Fantasy V, 4 Job Fiesta. It's for charity. You got to go through and, like, stay on a certain job, I believe. Anyway, if you're watching the live Twitch stream, it starts in 8 hours. If you just got this podcast episode, it has already started.
Yeah, don't worry though. FF5 isn't that long of a game if you haven't played it before, and it is just 4jobfiesta.com to register for the run. So if you guys are interested in that, dive on in. That would be a lot of fun if I had time to play Final Fantasy V again.
Yeah. This would be a post podcast.
Yeah, very much. Very much so, yes.
Okay, so Final Fantasy XIV's producer apparently discussed the possibility of bringing the bunny women from Final Fantasy XII or the Viera, the Viagra, the...
Yeah, well,
it's Viagra for Caleb. That's what I was thinking.
Scratching behind those ears.
Anyway.
Play with that fluffy tail.
I forgot we had that drop.
Yeah, dude. Oh, that was a great moment in that stream.
That was Dirge, right?
Yeah, that was Dirge. Like the last moment.
It was. I took the music out of that clip. I remember it was kind of a pain in the ass, but now it was just them and their moans.
Yeah. God, it was so good.
Okay, so the Viera, they were discussing ways to bring it into FF14. Some people were just apparently disappointed that there was no announcement of bringing that race into Stormblood, which I guess might have been expected by a few people. I didn't hear about any of this shit, so I don't know about that.
Who would expect that? Who would be like, I am surprised that they didn't connect it to Final Fantasy XII. I've never played it.
Online but news sources now are kind of bullshit. So, like, sometimes I go, oh, did two people say this and then someone wrote an article
about
this?
Yeah, it's like, 50% of them wrote this article and it's only credited as one person. So, yeah.
It was expected by me.
Anyway, so the producer, Yoshi P, I believe, said that don't give up hope yet. I mean, they might bring it in the future. But one of the big problems, and he joked about this, one of the big problems with bringing them into Final Fantasy XIV is that there's no shoes that can fit them because they wear very high-heeled shoes.
Oh,
wow.
So that was an official piece of news.
Wow, that's...
from Ultimate Final Fantasy. Now, this is something I had no idea about. Okay, so this is not really Final Fantasy news, except it's mildly Final Fantasy news. Anyway, in Japan... there is a streaming service that is launching or has launched or something like that called Yahoo Games. Now, apparently they tried this here and it crashed and burned, but Yahoo, believe it or not, is I believe, more popular than Google in Japan.
Wow.
So Yahoo Games,
they love their spam out
there. So Yahoo is like on top of the world in Japan. They use their email service a lot. And even this game streaming service that Yahoo has put out over there, I first of all didn't know this fucking existed, and am very intrigued, but apparently Yahoo Games is what it's called, and it's a streaming platform for games, and it's going to have Final Fantasy 13 and 13.2 on it. So, I was just like, what? There's a streaming service called Yahoo Games?
I knew they tried to do like a video one here, but I don't think it's that popular.
Oh, Yahoo Video?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's not.
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember there was one point when Google Video was a separate thing. There was like porn on it. And nice. Then Google bought YouTube, and now there's only YouTube.
Oh.
And I had some favorite videos at the time.
That are now gone?
Yeah, that are now non-existent.
That's too bad. Damn. That's lost art right there.
It is. It's lost art.
Joel never get those memories back.
Joel? Who's Joel?
It's a Joe.
Oh, Joel. Joe Will?
Joe Will.
Yeah, yeah, but you made it a compound word. You said Joel?
No.
Joel never get those memories back.
Yeah. Joel. You're I think you're E from a show.
Very well.
You're E from a show, Craig.
Lies.
Dude, I tell you why I don't hear very well. Because I went to a fucking Metallica concert 2 days ago, and it was fucking loud.
Yeah,
great.
Whenever people screamed in the audience, it was like, oh, man. There's like the little, like, you know, when the sound is so loud, it's like pressing against your eardrum. Like, there's a physical sensation of just, like, hurt.
Yeah, that's how that it happened. Was.
Anyway, so I allowed it, though, because I was like, I need to take all this in so that when I don't hear anything at 80, I'll have the memory.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah, like, it'll force its way into my memory through brute force of sound waves. Okay, Final Fantasy 14 Stormblood has a new trailer that details a whole bunch of jobs, stories, and battles, and I don't think we need to watch it because we've seen like 20 million Stormblood trailers to this point. But I'm sure if you're excited for Stormblood, which I was, and then I realized we're not going to play it for a long time, then that would be something to check out.
Yeah, remember, early access for that is beginning on June 16th for those who have pre-ordered Stormblood. So keep that in mind and dive in ASAP.
Mm-hmm. There is apparently one site.
Unless you're us, then don't dive in ASAP.
Oh, crap. What is the site called? Anyway, there is one place called GMC, apparently, where you can get the PC version of Stormblood off for 17%. So if you want to save some money, that's it's an article Shinra shared with us.
Yeah, it's a GMG.
GMG.
And it looks like the list price for the Digital Collector's Edition was $59.99.
It's on PC only.
$49.79. Stormblood regular from $39 to $33. So if you want to save a few bucks and you're not playing it on PlayStation like Joe and I, Google that shit and get yourself some savings, man.
Okay. All right. And then there is another trailer. Once again, this is a story trailer for FF12 Zodiac Age, which we don't...
A story trailer?
Yeah. We've
not
seen
that everybody's already
story
played 12
and gameplay
by this
trailers.
Point.
Not everybody has, dude. That is two game generations away from us right now. Dude, that game is 12 years old, Caleb.
I know, but still...
Or not
a
12,
story trailer for a game that's 12 years old.
11.
One of the best comments I'm looking at is Ash's ass in glorious HD. I'm ready.
I am too. You know, she fits in that skirt real well.
You ready for that bunny women in HD?
Dude, I've been ready since the day I was born.
I'm always on Team Ash, though. I gotta say, I'm on Team Ash on this one.
You like Ash?
I like Ash more than Fran. If I once again, if there was consent and I had to choose... that this is like our conversation last week on Nude Clan, where it's like, who would you rather bang? I'm like, well, they do have to want to bang me, which is the fantasy part of all this.
You gotta assume that they do.
That's what I normally assume, Craig.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, I was like, well, I mean, we're all choosing between Scarlett Johansson, Margot Robbie, or in this case, Ash and Fran. It's like, well, you're missing a step here. There has to be a point that's believable, where you are in a position where you can choose.
Well, I think the Vera are kind of like dryads, you know, like they steal men away for breeding purposes. Like
probably there are no dudes among them.
Their willingness is.
Or are they like black widows? Do they kill the mate?
I don't know. Balthier just gets like shredded.
Yeah.
That's why it's just sexual tension, is because he knows that, so he can't actually do anything. Yeah. He's just gonna lead her on so that he can like look at her. But
there's just like teeth in her vagina. It just like swallows him up.
Just turns him inside out.
Yeah. Eats him slowly.
Like, penis first. He's just. And then she opens up her jaw and eats him like a snake.
I would like to see that happen, actually. That exact thing that you just described.
That's pretty fucked.
Okay, well, write the movie. I'll direct it. Anyway, all right. Okay. So I didn't know what projection mapping was until today when I saw this article. Apparently, somewhere in Japan, against a building, and to celebrate the 30th anniversary of Final Fantasy, they got a pretty cool like light show thing against a building that has a bunch of Final Fantasy stuff on it. So if you want to see that video, it is online, but since this is a podcast, this will be no fun to listen to us go, ooh, ah, like,
no.
What they're doing.
We have an announcement trailer, though,
no,
guys.
This is the biggest piece of news this week. I hope you're ready for this. Once we get this
what's
video
it called?
Lined up. I Dissidia Final Fantasy NT.
Oh, Jesus.
NT?
Yeah, I don't know. What the fuck?
All right, let's see what this has got.
North Trade.
Team Ninja.
Ninja Team. Instead.
See how exquisite this world is?
No.
Alas, its beauty is fleeting. This land wavers on the brink of destruction. I humbly entreat you, pry my world from the grip of ruin. Lend me
silence, materia. Everything here belongs to me. As for you lot, you are to fight so that my realm decays no further.
Hey, this looks familiar.
Hi. Some battle footage.
Damage. 4,000. Alright, we got some Terra.
Wall.
Isn't he supposed to be dead?
He should be.
Oh, we got some jet shot going on. Some
titties.
Oh, what?
It looks kind of different from the other games that I played in the series.
Cloud and Sephiroth.
Summon.
Ramu. Shiva.
Oh, yeah. Scissor. Both my memories of warriors past. And the strength of my thralls have pledged to me. Are at your beck and call. Come. My world awaits. Dissidia NT or TN or whatever the fuck, because they're on top of each other.
TNT.
So there we go. That is the official Dissidia trailer. Now, okay. We've been seeing ads for that, and I am very familiar with that combat just because of the character additions that they've made over the years that we've stopped reporting on because we didn't give a shit anymore. because it's
we did have some news with that.
Yeah. Or it's like, hey, they're adding blah, blah, blah to this Japan-only arcade game. And it's like, we don't even have arcades anymore. Like, there's like one that I know of.
I can think of four right now.
There's one in Springville.
In Provo and Orem.
That's too much, dude. Well, I don't know how they exist.
They're usually connected with something else, though. So it's like a party place. So I mean,
usually,
Chuck E. Cheese's has arcade, but no adult wants to go there. There is a pure arcade place in the Provo Town Center Mall. There is two Nickelcades, I believe.
Yeah,
I want to say there might. And then there's Chuck E. Cheese's. So there's four. Four right there. There is something in Springville. Is it another Nickelcade?
It's like Nickelcade, but it's not called Nickelcade.
It's Pennycade because everyone's poor.
No, they still use nickels, but it's not called Nickelcade. So.
So they ripped off their business.
So is it Nickel City? Is that what it is?
I think you're right.
It might be
Nickel City, but yeah.
See? There's four right there.
All right.
Just in this little area.
But still, it's like, I don't know, it used to be a big thing, and now it's like, it's the hipsters, man, I'm telling you. Like,
I've never seen a hipster in an arcade store.
Dude, they're all hipsters. You just can't tell.
They're
real hipsters. They're hipsters that are actually hipster and not just like all looking the same, even though they don't want to look same.
What is that line from South Park? It's the conformists.
Oh, I can't remember.
It's the emo kids or the goth kids.
I love the goth
kids. And they're like, you don't want to be a conformist, so you got to dress like us.
You gotta dress exactly.
I can't remember
exactly
what the line is. It's too genius, but it's to that point where it's like, oh, I don't want to look like those people, so I'm going to look like these people instead. And you're still conforming. You're just conforming to a different group. Which is hilarious. It's, oh my god, it's genius. South Park's great, dude.
It is.
Yeah, check it out. It's Comedy Central.
It's also on Hulu. Season 19.
Yeah,
the great one. God, dude, love season 19.
Fuck, dude.
One have PC Principal?
Yeah,
the first season with PC Principal.
Yeah,
is the best season of television outside of the sixth season in Game of Thrones that I've seen. Of course, I don't watch that much TV.
The six seasons?
Sixth season.
Oh, I thought you were telling me all six were better, and I was like, well, that's not saying much considering that season five.
Anyway, it's like, dude, it's so good.
It's great.
It's so good. All right. Let's get to our discussion. Okay, so I found this article on Ranker.com, which is, of course, the place where you go for quality web content. Ranker, much like Cracked.
Oh, I thought you said Wanker.com, and I was like, that's where I go for all of my web content.
Bet you do, big boy.
Wow.
Okay, this is called 11 Wild Final Fantasy Fan Series That Will Link the Games Together.
Oh, Jesus.
Now, guess what? An actual canon one? Well, there was one canon one listed on here.
There's an actual canon
The other
one.
Actual canon one is not on here.
Wait, the canon from... Wait, is it the... After Years
after
that's
years
listed?
Canon. It's not listed.
What? That's probably because they never played it.
That's what I'm thinking, dude. Yesterday I was like looking for cool fan theories. I'm like, we gotta do another one of these episodes. We gotta delve in and like see this bullshit. Now there's some 13 ones we haven't touched and I totally forgot about. Twice brought them up today and I was like, oh yeah, the 13 ones. But
yeah, there were a lot of Lightning Returns ones.
Okay, cause... this is the first one listed. This is the Final Fantasy X and X-2 are prequels to FF7. We've already done a minisode on this.
Yeah.
But for a quick recap, apparently the kid in Final Fantasy X-2, whose name is Shinra, really interested in getting power from the planet.
I'm just a kid.
And may one day travel to the planet of FF7. Some people believe it's the same planet, but I don't think so, frankly. Might one day travel to the planet of FF7 and his ancestors... very distant ancestors will harvest energy from whatever that planet is.
Yeah.
So the idea is that the people from FF7, they came from the world of FF10, and the Shinra guy has been there since the beginning, and they've been like harvesting planet energy.
Yeah.
It is a retcon from Final Fantasy X-2's Ultimania guide. This is confirmed. This is real. It is stupid and bullshit, but this is real.
But you have to take it with a grain of salt and also a tune. Remember that this theory was confirmed by those who allowed this into the beginning of the game.
And we're going to get a comment. It's like, what are you talking about? That song is great.
The beginning of the game.
It and Eyes on Me is even better.
It starts off being insanely weebish. Like, Final Fantasy is not that intense weeb, right, Craig Caleb, wouldn't you say? Final Fantasy's kind of mid-tier, maybe a little low.
Yeah.
Until you get to 10-2, and then it just fucking rockets up, man. It just exits the atmosphere and goes straight to planet
if
Weeboo.
If it was one of those, like, fucking carnival strength testers, it hit the bell four times.
Yeah, it would blow through the bell and exit the atmosphere. And it's insane. Like, even 13-2, you have a floating Moogle that you throw. You throw this poor bastard. That doesn't even come close to 10-2s. So keep that in mind when viewing the theory that 10 and 7 are connected from Shin Ra.
But the thing is, it's not connected from FF10. It's connected from FF10-2.
Oh, dude. Final Fantasy VII Remake. There's going to be some lore in there.
Oh, my God. Don't you fucking say that. If they put 10-2 in that game,
dude, it'd be great if you could go into the library and, like, find the...
Find the history.
The legend of FF10. Oh my
god. Fucking Tidus is gonna be a bonus
what
character.
What can I do for you? Dude, I would I would uninstall.
Like, uninstall. Yeah.
Would you shoot it?
Maybe.
that means that they in fact are in the same universe, those two.
Yeah, they
but
are.
That one is confirmed by the makers of the game.
It is by the makers of 10-2.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, that is a good clarification.
No, let's not put them all in the same boat. Okay.
All right. This other theory is interesting. Gilgamesh proves the Final Fantasy franchise is a multiverse. So this one says, some fans believe that all the games are connected or at least share a multiverse due to a single character, Gilgamesh. Old Gilgamesh first appeared in FF5 and sacrificed himself by going through the dimensional vortex. As he went through, he said his only regret was not fighting Bartz one last time. Bartz is the main character of FF5, by the way. But that wasn't Butts. The last time.
Yeah,
Bartz. That's good. That's good. In the old fan translation English version, his name is Bartz. It's like Batsu in Japanese, so it could go either way. Not definitely not Bartz.
Well, if his name's Butts, he only goes one way, as far as I'm concerned.
They call me Butts for a reason, honey.
Yeah. Get up in there. Come on, get that glove on.
Oh, man. Speaking of Butts, Caleb Craig is on the show.
Yeah. Fuck you.
All right. But he says, that wasn't the last time we'd see the multi-armed swordsman. Gilgamesh would appear in other Final Fantasy games, sometimes even mentioning Bartz by name. His sporadic appearances suggest that he has been jumping from game to game via dimensional portals. And he still wants to, like, fight Bartz, I guess. Like, he
wants
just,
Bartz.
You Bartz, bro?
He's in this interdimensional, what is it, the X zone?
The end zone.
End zone.
I don't want to know what that end stands for.
And he got split apart, and he's just in different worlds looking for Bartz. Do you believe this one?
I kind of
buy this one. I kind of buy that, like, Gilgamesh, the exact same character, as just somehow, in its own unexplained Final Fantasy way, has been in multiple places looking for Bartz.
No, I call that bullshit.
Call that bullshit.
Yeah, I'm going to give it the Predator treatment. The Predator's outline, to me, is only visible to the audience so that we know where Predator is. I think Gilgamesh being in the games is a treat for the audience. I don't think it actually connects the universes at all. I think it's just a cool callback for us, and it's only meant for us, as opposed to actually being a canonized situation where Gilgamesh is jumping from area to area. Like, I don't buy the.
He's
it's
also
connected.
Like a secret, like summon innate. So, like, you have to have Odin in order to get Gilgamesh.
Yeah,
and Gilgamesh looks way different in that game than he does in, like, the other one.
True, but he does look similar in 5 and, like, 12. And
he doesn't have multiple arms that in 5, does he?
He does.
I don't remember. It's been a while since I played 5.
He's like the same guy in every one.
Yeah, he looks pretty similar.
Yeah.
Does he have the arm that's just like a little sign that's lit up by light bulbs? Because he does in FF8.
I don't remember that.
It's so really fucking weird.
Okay. I say I buy that at least in some of them he is possibly the same Gilgamesh.
Alistair says, doesn't someone see Predator's distorted camo? I don't know if it's that so much as like they heard a noise. I haven't watched Predator for a while, but that's what I feel like it is for us, because it is kind of obvious, and if they can see it just as well as I can, I don't understand how the people in the movie couldn't see Predator.
They're not supposed to see it. The camouflage is just there so you know where the
where he is. That's what I'm thinking. Yeah, like it is a full-on camo for the people in the movie.
Yeah, it's completely, because like completely invisible.
If I can see it, they should be able to fucking see it.
Yeah, there was
a
point in the movie, I think, where they throw mud at him or something so that they can see him when he goes invisible.
Pixel says the camo outline is supposed to be visible when wet. See, that makes sense.
Yeah, like wet or mud.
But you can see it anyway in the movie.
I feel like they do something like that in the movie so they can see it.
All right. Yeah. So this is the Predator podcast.
Yeah. Welcome to Predator episode one.
We're going to go through the Predator movies 1 minute at a time. Have you seen Predator 2?
Yeah, Predator 2 is not
fucking
sweet.
Terrible.
Predator is awesome.
Predator is a better bad guy than Alien to me. Cooler, but the Alien movies are way fucking better than the Predator movies.
I agree with the second part. I don't know if Predator is cooler to me than Alien.
I think it is. I think they're way cooler. They got so much more utility.
What happened in AVP Requiem? Who won?
I didn't watch
I didn't watch it either. It's supposed to be terrible.
I think Predator.
Because it was a stupid tie in the first movie.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, we won. Psych.
Well, then the Alien won.
Oh, against that one guy. Yeah, but he killed so many, man. Guy was a god.
Anyway. Yeah, that guy was sweet.
Movie sucks. God.
All right. Final Fantasy IV is a sequel to Final Fantasy II. We're talking about real numbers here. Not the Super NES numbers from the American release. There are some things that both Final Fantasy II and Final Fantasy IV have in common, aside from the fact that FF4 was originally titled FF2 in the United States, it says. In fact, FF4 might be a sequel that takes place 20 or so years after FF2.
Dun, dun, dun,
dun, dun. In Final Fantasy II, take this with a fucking barrel of salt here. There's a young boy named Kane who wants to be a Dragoon Knight. It is presumed that this boy is the son of the Dragoon Knight Rickard Highwind. In Final Fantasy IV, one of the main characters is Kane, of course, who is a Dragoon Knight. In the Nintendo DS version of 4, Kane mentions that his father was named Rickard and that he died fighting an evil empire. Coincidence?
Yes. I would say... I would say it's just something they put in later in a future port.
Yeah,
because
it was the Dawn of Souls, right? And then the DS version of ports. Yeah.
So this is where we disprove this one. The first thing that we disprove it on that I read in the forum where this was posted. First thing is Continental Drift does not happen in 20 years because the maps of 2 and 4 are quite different.
Yeah.
So that's number one. Unless, like, some earth-shattering bullshit.
Yeah, their tectonic plates are
years.
Fucking crazy.
In
on
which
this
case,
planet.
I would like to see Kane's, his story. You know, like, I want to see that.
Yeah.
That story. Also, like, the Summoner's Village in 4? Like, wasn't that supposed to be around for, like, hundreds of years?
Yeah.
Where the fuck was that in Final Fantasy 2?
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's number one on the bullshit side. Number two, obviously, this is not on the original FF2.
Yeah.
This is in a future port. I believe it's the Dawn of Souls version.
Right? Yes. Yeah, okay.
Also, the connector that makes it Kane to that FF2 port, that is also from a later port. So none of those were in the original games. Obviously, when they put it in the Dawn of Souls version, it was just to be a... I don't know, like a wink, wink, haha.
Yeah, it's the FF9 of
Easter
Final Fantasies where they're like, remember that? Yeah, it's connected.
Yeah, it's the Easter egg for fans.
So I would say that one definitely debunked. That's just fan fiction.
That one's bullshit.
It's just.
So you got triple bullshit on this one.
Yeah.
Do you confirm, by the way, we didn't ask you your opinion on that FF7 and FF10 one?
Yeah, it's bullshit.
It's bullshit. Okay. I let it slide.
I let it slide because they are in charge. And if I let Advent Children slide...
It's too much.
I'll let 10-2 slide.
Okay. It's too much.
I know that hurts.
Like, they have an existence of heaven in fucking 10, and there's just, like, a life stream, the Force, in 7. So it's, like, completely different, like, afterlife stuff.
Well, it's been, yeah, I mean, it's been Star Wars the whole
time.
Well,
you know, it's just, it's the planet.
No, they can't be judged by the planet. That's just fucking stupid.
Oh, so the afterlife isn't, like, isn't dependent on where you live?
Afterlife is a physical thing in both of those games. So you physically have a soul, and it goes to the far plane, and the memory of that person is, like, reawakened when you enter the far plane. In FF7, they go to the life stream, and we know
which is
from
the life force
fucking,
of the planet.
From the fucking novel,
yeah,
that the life stream has its own thoughts, and people within it have their own thoughts within
right,
the life stream.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
So it's heaven, in a way.
So yeah. It's an afterlife in its own way, but they're both physical manifestations. They both come from the planet. Admittedly, though, if the people from FF10 were an alien race brought to the FF7 one, which is the version I would most believe,
It can't be the same
planet. They wouldn't have a place in the fucking life force.
Yeah, I know. Exactly. That's what I was just about to say. I'm like, yeah. How do they return to the life?
They can't.
Unless
they're like all tainting the live stream because it's like, well, it died here. So
well, Genova is, I think, supposed to be the connection. So Genova, remember, Genova can't really do that. She's not part of the live stream. She's trying to destroy the planet.
Yeah, wasn't Sephiroth going to, like, taint the live stream, like, using it somehow?
Yeah. So I think that's the connector was Genova. I think Genova is what comes from. Yeah.
It doesn't physically make any sense.
Well, she's, like, from the from another planet.
Yeah,
it doesn't
say
it's from.
Well, obviously, it doesn't say it's from Spira because they didn't make Spira until years later.
Well, it's just as stupid as, like, fucking 12 being in the same universe as Tactics. It's like, oh, yeah, thousands of years later, just like every other race except for humans has just been eradicated.
Yeah.
It's for the same people, and then they said it was the same worlds. That one's real.
I'm waiting for the
I'm not arguing that there wasn't some serious genocide going on.
Yeah, there were like multiple Hitler figures that did the job.
I want the game about that.
But remember the FF.
That's what Celestine should be about. It's the mass genocide of like all those people.
I can't comment on this, but I can kind of assume that perhaps are they like the same. Are they the same kingdoms warring against each other in Tactics, or are they like different places? Because it could just be geographically in a different spot. 12, you don't go all over the world. You go through like one little, it's like a Tolkien thing. It's, you just go through this one little strip of land.
No, I think it covers like just one country. But it still has like airships being like ancient things. And they have like people who know what guns are, but that's only because they're like archaeologists.
Okay.
So it's like, it was a long fucking time ago.
All right. Final Fantasy IX possibly took place in the first Final Fantasy world.
Okay.
So some fans believe that FF9 took place years after the first Final Fantasy in the same exact world. The geographical boundaries in both world maps look similar, which I did not confirm this, but perhaps someone can look up a world map of FF9 and FF1. They have similarly named landmarks, such as Mount Gulag. In addition, both games require the party to defeat a Lich, Merilith, Tiamat, and Kraken Fiends. There is another big connection between the two games, a main villain named Garland. When you defeat Garland in the first Final Fantasy, the game says he will be waiting for the Warriors of Light in the future. This could suggest that Garland from FF1 and FF9 are the same guy. Bullshit or not?
It's bullshit.
I'll say half bullshit. I say they did set it up in Final Fantasy I, which is a rare treat, given what we've seen thus far with these fan theories.
Because in Final Fantasy I, he was stuck in a fucking time loop because he created a paradox that he went back in time and fucking saved himself. So the reason that he's waiting for the people in the future is because he went back in fucking time.
Oh, that's true. That's a good
point.
That's
why. So there's no connection.
Dude, that's
just
why.
All right, they just use the name Garland because they like it, and that's it.
Everybody loves a good Garland.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. You know what? Okay, fine. I'll adjust it to 3/4 bullshit. This is one of those canon moments where it doesn't necessarily upset the canon, except for it does a little bit with a 1,000-year thing, although 9 could be 100 years, so he could have done all the events of 9... Well, okay, I guess here's what would have to happen. You would have to have different instances of reality where, like, you can die 100 years from now, but the 1,000 years from now version of you is still alive. So it would have to be, like, multiple strands where each one does exist, but only in a specific...
That's just way too complicated. Yeah. A fucking time loop paradox shit.
Yeah, I don't think they could actually manage a story Garland, like that, if I'm going to be honest here.
Garland was just like a knight of the king in the first fucking game. Like, that's it.
Yeah.
He's not a super beast?
He's not like some crazy super fucking dude in, like, he is in fucking 9.
That's true. I love him in both games, though. I'll say that. I think he's great. But no, I don't think he's the same Garland. There's no
way. He doesn't even have the same character.
And saying that, oh, Tiamat is in the game. Tiamat is in, like, many Final
Fantasy
games.
The Garland in FF9 had a sense of humor at all, and he's kind of humorous. Like, he is actually somewhat of a character in that first Final Fantasy game.
Yeah, he's the only one that has a
personality. And in 9, he's just, like, vicious and awesome. Yeah. He's great, but... yeah, FF1, he really is like the only person that like you remember from the game.
Yeah.
Because the characters are D&D characters.
Okay, I got some loose ones here that I'm calling bullshit on all of them. All the Final Fantasy games are connected through Eidolons.
No. Again, fan service for us.
Hein from Final Fantasy 3 empowered the sorceresses in Final Fantasy 8, so they're suggesting that 8 and 3 are in the same universe.
No. What?
I could see 1 and 3 being in the same universe, but no.
This is one I don't understand. Three faces of Eve represents three stages in a woman's life. And then it connects a whole bunch of Final Fantasy games saying that there's three female characters in all these different Final Fantasy games that represent the same things. And that's a way that they are somehow thematically connected, which
that doesn't
to me, it's just what? Like... They're just using the same archetypes in the different Final Fantasy games. I don't think that means anything with like physical.
You know what?
Connection.
They're all, you know, Game of Thrones and Lord of the Rings and Star Wars are all connected because they all have a hero.
There is a dude on YouTube that apparently put all the main games within the same timeline. He like really forced them all into a timeline and
like into the same universe.
It's a 1-hour video that I am not watching.
It's like, okay, which one looks the most futuristic? Which one looks the least futuristic? Let's just fill it in.
They are saying that some of the Cids may be the same Cid in different universes.
I don't buy that either.
No. I don't buy that at all.
No.
FF11's is probably all of them.
Okay. FF6 happened 1,000 years before FF4 in the same... Oh, excuse me. FF4 took place 1,000 years before FF6 in the same world. Hear this. Some fans believe that the Americanized numbering of FF4 and FF6 as FF2 and FF3 is more appropriate than people realize. Some evidence suggests that the War of the Magi actually happened in FF4 1,000 years before, and that was the war that actually took place before FF6. A callback that makes FF4 look like a... or FF6 look like a sequel to 4 just 1,000 years later. They also suggest that the warring triad depicted in the statues of FF6 was actually the three Lunarians from FF4.
Boop, boop, boop.
Do you believe that the War of the Magi was actually FF4?
No. It just sounds more 4 stuff.
No, it sounds like
it's like
bullshit.
They're trying to connect 2, 4, and 6 together.
Yeah. And then the final piece of bullshit. These are weak fan theories. It's the least of a list of really weak fan theories. And this is the weakest of them all. Final Fantasy 3 and FF9 have the same final boss. Now in Final Fantasy 3, you got the Cloud of Darkness, and in Final Fantasy 9, you have Necron. And they're suggesting, though, they look extremely different.
Yeah, because one's a fucking chick.
Because they're both like the same sort of entity within their own game, or they're this like floating black death thing that just decides it wants to destroy stuff, that it's the same thing. Do you buy this?
No, not at all. I think they're all different final bosses.
You see them in both games. That's the problem.
Just because it's a physical manifestation of just like evil doesn't mean that it's the same one. Yeah. It could just be just a manifestation of evil.
Yeah, that was bullshit. Okay, now there is one that we need to mention here that wasn't even in this goddamn list. At the end of Final Fantasy, I'm going to give some spoilers away if you've never played After Years. At the end of After Years, you find out that a lot of shit has been caused by this thing called the Creator. and you go down into the depths of the creator's things, and you have to fight all these final bosses from the first four Final Fantasy games. And you find out that the creator has put crystals on different planets to record the history of each planet or whatever, and that the creator, this entity, is going through and destroying the planets that had failed her or whatever.
Okay.
Anyway, that is the real connection between the first, I believe, five games. Any of the games in the Final Fantasy universe that have the crystals in them, that is the connection that brings them together. It's a retcon connection put from a sequel to FF4 that took place like 20 years later.
Yeah.
Honestly, though,
it was made 20 years later.
Yeah, honestly, it's the best one that they've ever done, I would say.
It's the best retcon out there, so this is a real one.
Because it's non-invasive.
It is. Exactly. So the creator was the one who brought at least those crystal games together. And so that was a retcon I thought was cool. For some odd reason, it's not in that list, probably because it's not a fan theory. It's one actually put out by Square Enix.
Yeah.
But the FF7, FF10 one is also put out by Square Enix. It's anyway, true. So if you want a real connection to the Final Fantasy games...
That's it.
That's the only one. 10 and 7 one.
And if you like FF4, you should probably play After Years. It's fun.
Yeah, it is fun. I'm not going to say it's the greatest narrative of all time, but it's fun.
It's better than most of the spinoffs, though, to be honest. Not that that's hard company to defeat. That's like Dirge. That's like beating up a bunch of toddlers with like a bat.
Dirge
like,
and 10
you'll probably win for a very long time. Army of toddlers.
Yeah, we have tried it, so yeah we can
wave 10,000 gets pretty tough.
You're like a Sauron at the beginning.
Fellowship of the Ring.
Just like send them flying.
That's
not got cool. Like a plastic baseball bat. It's like
wow, you're so disgusting.
All right, you know, watch that movie.
All right, Schweiss has pulled up a couple questions, so let's get to those, babies.
We had some madness going on
here. Gotta be careful with those windows.
I know, they like to yell at us. So, Triple Triad / Tetramaster from Black Mage Justin. Sorry if this has been asked. Kind of new to the forums. I feel like I've heard that the guys enjoy Triple Triad more, despite the stupid rule change thing. I'll be honest, I like the dumbed-down Tetramaster more. I was able to collect every card in 9. Actually, my wife wanted to try Triple Triad and absolutely destroyed it and helped me get all the cards, which helped me... with the Omega weapon fight using the card to item ability. Anyways, how far into the card games did you all get into? Which one did you enjoy more? Would you go back and retry the card games? Okay. I liked Tetramaster more when I played 8, but when we went to KoopoCon and we got the
Triple Triad.
No, I like Tetramaster more.
Tetramaster's from 9.
Yeah, I know.
Oh. When you said you played 8, I was confused.
When I played 9, I like Tetramaster more than 8 because I hate... I don't like card games in games, okay? I like real card games like poker and cribbage and, you know, like spades.
Cribbage is for men.
Cribbage is for men, okay? Game of points. The card games I never really got into, and I liked Tetramaster more. Of course, I actually had to play Tetramaster, so that might have been part of it. When I went through 9, I was like, you know, this is fun. I'm not going to do it optionally because I want to play the game. But I enjoyed my short stint with Tetramaster. Now, with KoopoCon, we got Triple Triad cards, and I don't know. I kind of like Triple Triad more, honestly. Like, I think it's more enjoyable. It's an easier game. When the rules are the OG rules, of course. But no, I don't think I'd go back to retry the card games necessarily. I might play them as I play the games, but I would never exclusively jump into FF8 or 9 to like, oh, I'm going to dive deep into the cards. That's not something I want to do.
Craig?
I don't like any of the card games in fucking Final Fantasy.
Which do you prefer?
The one that I prefer is Gwent from Witcher 3.
Yeah, they made their own game.
Yeah, they have their own card game in Witcher 3, and it's fucking better. It's just fucking better.
It's fucking better.
I love that game. Dude, you can, like, bet people.
Did you fuck
like
Triple Triad?
Yes. Oh. I tried them. I tried them, and I hate them.
Okay.
I hate them. Well, okay. The one from 9 is nowhere near as bad as the one from 8, though.
I disagree.
Dude, the one from 8, they keep changing the rules and then it's fucking bullshit.
You are right. The rule change is
we'll
when
place
I
place the card right here, and then every single card will just get flipped, and then you get fucked. It's stupid. It's so stupid.
Depends on how good your cards are.
Anyway. It's like an older sibling trying to teach a younger sibling how to play a game, and like, oh yeah, by the way, this is a rule. I win.
I will agree.
It's a game of house rules.
It is. It is exactly what it is. It's like playing Monopoly wrong. Makes it take 4 hours. The only reason Monopoly takes 4 hours is because you got your fucking stupid house rules on it. Free parking is not free money. It is not. It is literally an empty space. You just sit there and wait for the next turn.
You just thank God that you didn't get fucked by the properties around
and
it.
And if you can't pay for the property you land on, guess what? Goes into a bidding war with everybody else.
Yep, it's fast.
That's it. Yep. Okay, guys, stop playing your fucking house rules of Monopoly. That's why you hate the game.
It's true.
Game is a good game if you play the rules.
Joe and I literally had a game that took 15 minutes. It was terrible.
It was like 50 minutes.
No,
I doubt it was 15.
Okay, it was no more than a half an hour.
Okay, all right. It was really short.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's just because people are playing house rules. Anyway, this is why Triple Triad sucks. It's only because of the house rules. I would argue that regular stripped-down Triple Triad is a very fun, simple game.
It is, but you can never play it. Because you're constantly changing. Because
as soon as you get that herpes virus going, dude, it's everywhere.
Yeah,
the worst rules.
It's trippies.
Are
That's
everywhere.
What it is in that one, remember?
The winner take all and the flip every card in a row one. Whichever those rules are called, they're fucking terrible. The first thing that happened when we played FF8 most recently for this show, I fucked up the rules somehow. I talked to the wrong person at the wrong time and it just spread. And I was like, guess what? Can't do that one achievement that I wanted.
It's like, all right, well, I'm going to have to line up all of these people to play and mass execute all of them to clear this, to purge these rules from the land.
Yeah, dude. Get rid of house rules.
It's like fighting communism.
Anyway.
that's what it needs to be. We need to invade.
I still don't understand the other game, so I don't have an opinion.
Yeah, so Skull Hades said, never got into Triple Triad, but I too get all the Tetra Master cards. So Triple Triad is definitely the more popular one, but 8 is also a much bigger game than 9, so, you know, take that as you will.
All right. Let's go straight to reviews, Schweiss.
Reviews? What are you talking about?
We got some iTunes reviews, including.
Fine. Let me find the fucking jingle here. Catch me with my pants down.
That's right.
Just the way you like it.
That's the way we all like it.
iTunes reviews. Ah, so good. So good, dude. All right.
Okay, this is from the US of I.
This is the podcast for champions by Marth 2112.
It's true.
Caleb and Joe's show is overall one of the best podcasts when involving a discussion between two people. They have wit and great humorous dialogues. Oh, and their video game knowledge is pretty good. I think what makes this duo awesome is their balance of stupidity. Caleb, speaking of stupidity, Caleb Craig
on the show today.
Intellectual conversations.
Fuck you both.
And video game knowledge. Can't wait to hear the review on FF Tactics. Caleb Craig will also be on the show that day, I'm sure.
It's like sometimes they're smart, sometimes they're really stupid. Okay.
They got a healthy balance of their stupidity.
Healthy balance of why is there no oxygen in the room? And wow, there's not enough. Too much oxygen. Definitely replaying that when you get around.
Fuck.
The difference between too much and not enough oxygen. That's what I was trying to say.
Exactly.
Yeah, that is exactly what's happening. You guys breathe in at the same time as me, and I couldn't.
You just took all the air.
Yeah, we're like Lance Armstrong.
Maybe it was over here.
Yeah.
You would think Caleb Craig would be able to walk through New York if his lungs were that
big. Maybe we should open up a door so Caleb could breathe.
Maybe. All right, we have one here from Japan. It's titled The Best.
I have a feeling this person is not Japanese because of how they wrote this.
By the Geo Stigma dude.
These guys bring personality and fun banter in FF podcast world that usually takes itself
too seriously and sticks its nose up at the series. These are guys that take a realistic look at the series' best and worst moments.
I am now Russian. Russian man living in Japan, okay?
Oh, shit.
If I had one complaint, it would be that the mixing on some of the music interludes is too loud and has woken me up a handful of times in the middle of night.
Oh, why? So, I love the show, but I like to be asleep when listening to it.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. 10 out of
love
10.
Love to come into your dreams.
10 out of 10. Wood bang. So we should do that. We should fuck with them now. Just like after the end of this episode, be like, give us all of your money. So you just incept this man and his this Russian Japanese man. Thank you guys for your reviews of the show.
Thank you very much.
It goes a long ways to help us out and, you know, whatnot and what have you. I also have one little thing. I'm going to start reading these little contact forum things.
Well, you said that a while ago.
I did, and then I didn't do it. This one is from Jacody. He says, hey, guys, Joe and Caleb.
When was this?
This was some time ago. This is the Geekdom site, though, so it's not as bad.
Says it on the side right there.
10/8/2016.
Oh, okay. That's not
a year ago?
Yeah, it's when we set up Geekdom as the site. Okay. Hey guys, Joe and Caleb, neighbors. I'm from South Jordan. Just wanted to say thanks for the podcast. I'm a big Final Fantasy lover. Starting with number one, right when it came out on the NES. I'm 35, by the way. Then 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 14, and currently playing 13. Plans to revisit 6, 10, 12 in the next year or two. Well, now you can tell us if he did. As well as a little installment called 15 on November 29th. Currently a PC-only player. Hate consoles, long story, but will be buying a PS4 just for 15. Once 15 is beaten, the PS4 will be making its way to eBay. Anyway, I like the show because I have not found any others.
16 comes out and he has to buy one again.
Yeah, that are as in-depth as yours, so thank you for that. And you guys are pretty funny, too, and I guess we do agree on some stuff.
And pretty stupid and intelligent.
Yeah, apparently.
Healthy balance of stupidity.
And intelligence.
Real healthy.
So just middle ground?
Yeah.
Average intelligence.
Average. Thanks.
I was really excited when firing up the very first podcast to hear that you guys were from Provo. I was like, yes, finally, a podcast hosted by good BYU boys who are going to keep it clean
BYU?
And leave out all the cursing. Yeah, not so much. I'm just going to throw a few things out here that you should know. I'll start with the fact that I hold FF8 as my favorite in the entire series. Yep, beaten it 4 times. Love
it's
the game.
It's the pollution in Salt Lake.
Yeah, it fucks with you. I don't know. I mean, I hate the draw system, hate the Laguna crap, and even though the story had holes like old underwear, the other parts I just loved. Love Renoa.
What's left?
Love the romance. And he loves Eyes on Me. That's right, Joe. Suck it. Eyes on Me is pure gold.
He's gonna
polished turd.
I liked it enough to cover it.
Yeah.
I mean, what? I didn't cover that song.
We paid for it to be covered. We produced it.
Sure.
I'm going to throw out my rankings real fast since I know you guys get giddy about that ranking. Let's see. Best to worst, 8, 7, 6, 10, 12, 14, 9, 13, 1. But love them all, even though number one gave me a nightmare when I was a kid. It's so bad that he deleted all his saves when he woke up. That's insane. Thanks for the show. I'm going to ask my wife if she'll let me send you any money. Please do.
Did she?
No. I don't remember any money from Utah. So what's going on, bro? Yeah, thank you for
his
leaving
wife
us
said no, obviously.
Yeah, yeah. I need to ask her what's going on. Thank you so much for the submission. I have one more little thing that I want to touch
from
on
us to you as well.
Oh yeah, you're right. I've mentioned this before, guys, but I've been contacted by the Speed Gamers, and they're doing a Final Fantasy run through of the entire series for charity. You can follow them at twitch.tv/thespeedgamers. I'm going to probably put something up on the site once I get some images from them so we can help them promote it. And they can, you know, help us as well. Hopefully it'll work out well. I know they have a shitload of Twitch followers. It's usually a really big deal for them. Every once in a while they do this Final Fantasy stream thing, as well as other series. But if you guys are interested in that, we'll be hosting them. But you can follow them yourselves at that URL and just keep an eye on our website for further details as we get a little bit closer to that. I believe that is in July, if I thinking correctly.
And our website is UltimaFinalFantasy.com. You can go to YouTube.com/UltimaFinalFantasy as well. Facebook.com/UltimaFinalFantasy. You can support the show if you want to by going to UltimaFinalFantasy.com, clicking on the Amazon banner, the PayPal banner, or the Patreon banner. Thank you so much to our Patreon donors, by the way. This episode is, of course, supported by them. You can tweet me at Joseph DeGaulier.
Me at Obsidian Ba.
Me at UFF Podcast.
All right, Schweiss, questions from us to you, and we'll wrap it up. Okay, we had two. We're covering two people's episodes here.
Yeah, so last week, or a couple weeks ago, I said, which three quests, dungeons, or fights do you deem necessary before Joe and I exit Final Fantasy XIV? Bertoff says, these may be too general, so pick one if you need to. The Miachi quest line takes you through the three 24-man dungeons, which are Void Arc, Weeping City, Omayak, and Dunsaith. The optional 8-man trials, Warring Triad, Sephiroth, Sophia, and Zervon. At least do the normal modes for the story. The extremes are great fight mechanics and really fun, but can be pretty tough. And his final one, the Alexander Raid story mode. A1 to A12 is fun, light 8-man raids. You could try Savage, but not sure why you would, given that you're in a hurry. As much as I wish you had done the Binding Coil, it is really part of A Realm Reborn and should have been part of that review. The above three or nine, depending on how you want to count it, are more related to Heavensward than Coil. The Aquapolis is a fun treasure map add, and Heavensward and Palace of the Dead floors 1 through 100 are great content, but I wouldn't say essential to the Heavensward experience. They are more of a fun group time sink. Very fun so far. In regard to you not having dungeons so far, there are really only two dungeons tied to the story in 3.0 leveling portion of Heavensward. There will be dungeons tied to the story every patch. After that, at level 60, you will get plenty of group play post 60, especially if you do the three above. Alistair says, the timing for this Heavensward playthrough has kind of screwed you guys. The more you do the bare basics of a Heavensward run through, the more you miss out on. For the review, I'll tell you this will really hurt. Essential, it depends on how we define it. He would say Ozma and Weeping City is a must-see for longtime FF fans. It's also a bitchin' fight on a scale you haven't seen yet. He says go back and do the whole Coil storyline, but that is 13 fights. I don't see why you wouldn't do the Warring Triad, three separate fights, normal difficulty, less than 10 minutes
apiece. Warring Triad now?
Yeah. Okay. With a good team, surely you're not that strapped for time. And he wants to say the Dark Knight quest line is amazing. Buy a jump potion with Stormblood to boost it, then burn through the story missions. Not even joking. Not going to pay for that. Leo Empire says, if you're only going to pick three things, what Bertoff said would be the things to do. But should you decide to pick one more thing, something that really adds to the story and is technically optional, is the paths we walk. All it entails is going to talk with some of the NPCs to see how they've been doing, but it's a nice little bit of story content that I imagine would be easy to miss if you're just pushing through the main story quests. It becomes available after Library of Peace. Gabrant says, if we're talking Heavensward and as well as Heavensward, pre-Heavensward and Heavensward, I can pick three easy ones. Crystal Tower, Coils of Bahamut, and the entire Alexander Raid. Normal, not Savage. All three have very important things to offer to the story. And, of course, I'll be there to help.
Well, you know. Okay.
Yeah, Warring Triad, Alexander, Void Arc, I'm seeing, from Machete Facelift.
Okay. Let's do Warring Triad.
Alistair said, have we considered not slowing down and just letting the changes happen?
Not slowing down? Or you mean slowing down? We have considered slowing down. We talked about it last week.
Yeah. I don't know what he means by that. But yeah, it looks like Warring Triad and Alexander are kind of necessary.
Warring Triad, Alexander, and I want to say, fine, I want to do the Coils Bahamut one.
Yeah, even if it's late. Like,
because I've heard of that one too much. So
yeah,
let's do those three.
All right, that's those are the three we'll do.
Okay.
Jake also threw up a question asking what next mobile FF game him and the guys should review. Looks like a lot of people are saying Record Keeper, Brave Exvius, Dimensions, Mobius, all over the place.
All of them?
Exvius. A lot of
there
people
were two
saying,
that said Record Keeper, so I'm assuming Record Keeper has the most.
Seeing two Record or Exvius, three Exvius, four Exvius.
Okay, so it's Exvius.
So Exvius and then Record Keeper. So Jake,
Exvius gets the
and company. Those are the two.
There you go.
You guys should do.
All right, guys. Well, I think that's going to be it for this episode. Remember to go check out that charity stuff.
the old charity stuff.
Yeah, Job Fiesta and the run of the whole series from the other guys.
Yeah.
Like I just said.
Yeah, I'll put a link to their Twitch in the episode description so you guys can follow them there as well. So, and I'll keep bringing it up in the future. So, I mean, you guys will know about it. It'll be a lot of fun. Okay. I'm jealous that years of our work will be done in like a week from them.
Yeah,
it's disgusting.
They have to know the games really well in order to do that.
That's true, yeah.
Slash. So, I mean, they put in their time, obviously.
Very true.
Slash, they're not reviewing the games.
Yeah, that's fair. But anyway, guys, we'll see you again in 1 week's time. But until then, enjoy the grind.
This has been another production of Ultima Final Fantasy, the Ultimate Final Fantasy Podcast. The show was produced by Joseph DeGaulier and Caleb Schweiss, with music and editing by Joseph DeGaulier, parodies and clips from their respective authors, of course. You can get all of our episodes as well as our Let's Plays at UltimaFinalFantasy.com. You can also contact us on Twitter at UFF Podcast, as well as our contact page on our website. Be sure to subscribe and review our podcast. Your reviews may get read on the show, and look forward to the next episode of Ultima Final Fantasy, the Ultimate Final Fantasy Podcast.